So in this presentation, I'll be talking about Auckland's Heritage Counts program, and that's basically a whole lot of research and statistics relating to Auckland's heritage, which comes out in a report every year. And so as Shona said, I have a PhD in geography, but I did a heritage topic, so that was on the cultural heritage management of natural protected areas in New Zealand. And then I started up at the heritage unit at Auckland Council and the heritage policy team in 2013. And then after a couple of years, I decided to that I'd go on my OE and head over to London, where I managed to get a job at Historic England. And as Shona said, that's where I got the idea for starting up this program. So I came back in early 2017 to the same job and started setting up this program. So in this talk, I'll talk a little bit about setting up Auckland's Heritage Counts, and then I'll share with you the highlights from the latest edition, 2021 edition, and also some of the some highlights from the other editions from 2018. And I'll probably talk for around about 45 minutes or so there'll be a little bit of time for questions. Right, so setting up Auckland's Heritage Count. So as I said, so back in 2015, I decided to take a two-year leave to go over to London, and managed to get a really interesting job at Historic England, which was formerly known as English Heritage. And there I worked mainly on their Heritage Counts project. So England's Heritage Counts. And this is just an image of where I was working. So it was Waterhouse Square in Holborn. So quite a cool sort of historic building. So England's Heritage Counts program. So their one was set up in 2002. And it's their annual audit of England's historic environment. And it's well regarded around England and the UK and even in Europe as well. We even had a delegation come from Norway to come over to London to see the kind of stuff that we were doing. And on the screen there, these are the products that come out every year. So they have a research section where there's a new theme every year, and research is done on that. Then historic environment overview, which basically goes through the highlights of what's been happening in the heritage sector over the past year. Heritage indicators, which relate to a whole lot of statistics and it's a whole lot of statistics from dating back from 2002 and sometimes even earlier as well. So they can show their trends. And heritage and the economy, heritage and society, and heritage and the environment, which is actually a new one. These booklets show the research from the past 5 years or so recent research on heritage and the economy or society or the environment, to show some key statistics and key findings relating to those things. So when I was there, I worked on the 2015 Heritage Counts and 2016 and a little bit on the 2017 one. So the 2015 one was on the theme was heritage and the local environment. And so what we did there was a survey of listed building owners, so owners of of homes that are protected for heritage. So that was sent out to 10,000 owners, and just to get their perspectives of owning their own a listed heritage place and their experience with the planning system. Then in 2016, the theme was heritage and place making. And so with that, we focused on bids, business improvement districts, and how they use heritage to help with their place branding and how they sort of use heritage to attract people to their towns and businesses. And then 2017, that was the 50th anniversary of conservation areas in England, and so that was the theme, and so various sort of research pieces for that. So I found that really fascinating, and it was really great working over there with such a big sort of and entrenched sort of program, England's Heritage Counts. And so I returned to Auckland, and I thought that it would be really good to start up something similar in Auckland. But I found that we didn't do this kind of research, and we didn't have these kinds of statistics readily available. And but of course, we generally know that heritage is valued by Aucklanders. Just anecdotally, we know there are passionate locals that really care about heritage and complain if there are any perceived bad outcomes. And also we know people love visiting heritage, and people love looking at heritage places as well. But the value has not really been fully recorded or understood. And of course, at the same time, we also know that sometimes people don't feel the same way about heritage. And here are a couple of quotes. These are quotes from real people. I'll just put up a few of these. Too much heritage is protected. We don't have real heritage sites like in Europe. Too young to have heritage. Heritage not that important. Time to modernize Auckland. Heritage no real bearing on people's lives. No relevance to me. Gets in the way of progress and a waste of ratepayers' money. So you can see there that on one side, we do know that people really love heritage, but also on the other side, there are sometimes these perspectives that heritage is quite a burden. So it's in this context that I set up Auckland's Heritage Counts program. And as Shona mentioned, the aim to present or highlight the variety and extent of Auckland's heritage and the social and economic benefits that these places have. So trying to put heritage in a positive light and getting an evidence base together to show how and why heritage counts in Auckland. And in order to do this, I got the support of the heritage unit, and had to work out what data there was available out there and how to actually collect that data. And so I talked to a variety of people within the heritage unit and within other within the heritage sector as a whole, and different heritage agencies and groups. And then went about thinking about how I could set something like this up. And so this is what has been produced so far. Auckland's Heritage Counts, Ka Whae Taki Ngā Tōnga Toku Iho o Tamaki Makaurau. So, so you see on the right there, the 2021 edition, that's actually literally just been completed by the designers, so it should be on the website either today or at least by the end of the week. So that's quite exciting to have that one done. And I did want to mention here that it's not just been me that's been working on this. I've had great support from the Heritage unit with contributors, analysis, photographs, and proofreading, and also from other departments within Auckland Council as well, with the design team, GIS and comms, and also I've got data from various agencies and groups of people, and also from graduates of the University of Auckland's Heritage Masters program. I've been able to put in a few of their research projects into some of these editions. So what I'll do now is I'll talk a little bit about the some of the highlights from the 2021 edition, and then I'll talk through a couple of quite interesting research pieces of research that were done from some of the similar from the past reports. Right, so this is the first lot of stats. So first of all, we've got statistics about the overall number of heritage places in Auckland. So there are 2,474 historic heritage places and 18 historic heritage areas. So these are ones that are protected in the Auckland Unitary Plan, as well as the Hauraki Gulf Islands District Plan. And also did a bit of playing around with GIS and managed to work out this interesting statistic, which is that around 42% of all Aucklanders live within a 5 minutes walk of a protected heritage place. So so that I found that quite interesting. So it's not it's all really sort of all around us, and we took 5 minutes to be around about 400 meters. And this is where they're all located. You see there a bit of a concentration around the central city, and also on the north shore, and also lots of coastal regions. Most of those are archaeological sites. And just a note that this one, the dots are just for the Auckland Unitary Plan, so not the Hauraki Gulf Islands District Plan. So there would be a few more dots on Waiheke Island and some of the other islands. So so you can see here from this that that they're located all throughout the Auckland region. And also managed to work out these statistics. So under 0.5% of Auckland's land area is protected for historic heritage, and under 1% of property parcels in Auckland are protected for historic heritage. So just looking at sort of these statistics as a whole, so it shows that heritage is all around us and it is throughout the Auckland region, but when you think about it, it's quite a minuscule amount that's being protected, so it's not such a huge burden as sometimes it's considered. This graph here shows the breakdown of the types of places that are protected for historic heritage. You can see there's that 29% of heritage places are protected heritage places are residential, 24% are Maori origin archaeology, 11% commercial, and 10% civic institutional buildings. So those are things like libraries, post offices, and town halls, things like that. So from this, you can see there is quite a variety of places that are protected for heritage. So it's not just the sort of old residential buildings that are protected, but actually quite a variety. And of course, there are other protected places with historical interest as well. So we've got 50 special character areas, and these are the ones in located around sort of Ponsonby, Greylin, Mount Eden, Mount Albert, and Devonport. So those sort of areas where you see lines of villas, bungalows, and other typologies. And there's also around 3,000 or just under 3,000 notable trees, and many of these have are protected for their historical values. And this is an image of Albert Park, which is one example. And also there are sites and places of significance to mana whenua, and so these, so there's 105 of those places protected. And in fact, in the latest edition, there's a case study on this. So the on the Māori Cultural Heritage Program, so this was done by Lucy Rosita, who worked with us for a few months this year. And it shows the amount of work, the great work that the Māori Cultural Heritage Program is doing with actively working with mana whenua to work out the best ways to manage and protect these sites and places. And so there've been a couple of plan changes which have added sites, or one added 30 sites to be protected in the Auckland Unitary Plan, and one added four to the Hauraki Gulf Islands District Plan. And this case study really emphasises how much of a loss that there's been of mana whenua places of significance, because although there's 105 places protected and around and 595 places which are in the heritage schedule identified as being of value to mana whenua, it does seem a minuscule amount compared with the hundreds of years of Māori living in Auckland. So it's quite a long-term program. And also there was a case study by Rebecca Ramsey in the Heritage Unit, and this one raises awareness about climate change and heritage, and specifically sea level rise and heritage. So this graph here shows the proportion of sites affected by various sea level rise scenarios. So you can see that the highest proportion actually relates to places of significance, sites and places of significance to mana whenua. So you can see that those purple bars. So if there was a 3 meter sea level rise, then 60% of those places would be affected. And also places scheduled in the Hauraki Gulf Islands District Plan, the pink bars are also quite a high number as well. So just sort of, this raises the this awareness of how places will be affected by sea level rise. And some other really interesting statistics. So this one is about online engagement and showing how just how interested Aucklanders are in heritage and through this online engagement. So it shows, so you can see here, we've got the Auckland Council Heritage social media. So we've got Facebook and Instagram. And we also have a quarterly newsletter, the Te Kahu Focus on Heritage e-newsletter, which comes out every season. And we have our Auckland Council Heritage webpage as well. And if you're interested in Auckland's heritage, then it would be really good for you to sign up to these social media platforms, Auckland Heritage, Facebook or Instagram, or you can sign up to our newsletter as well. And so you can see that over the past couple of years, there's been really good increase in on these social media platforms. And so that really shows how much interest people have in heritage and how Auckland is engaged with heritage. And this could also be because of the lockdowns that we've had over the last couple of years. We did notice an increase last year on the Facebook followers following the first lockdown. And we also have this graph here shows the demographics of the Auckland Heritage Facebook page, which is quite interesting to show. So we've got the age groups there, and also 62% being female and 37% being male, 71% living in Auckland and 88% living in New Zealand. So we've actually got a few from overseas as well. And another indicator which shows how Aucklanders are passionate about heritage is through these statistics here. We're showing 59 heritage trails in Auckland and 95 heritage or historical societies in Auckland. So these really show how Aucklanders can enjoy and are enjoying heritage. This is another really interesting lot of data. So this is the Auckland Visitors Survey. So this is run by Auckland Unlimited, used to be called ATEED. And so this survey comes out every year, and they ask tourists in Auckland various questions about if they're the kinds of places that they're visiting and kinds of things that they are doing. And normally it's divided into domestic and international visitors, but of course over the past year also we haven't had really any international visitors. So this data here just shows what has just shows domestic tourists. So you can see on the right there that this shows the proportion of visitors who visited art galleries, museums, historic sites by region in Auckland. You can see 15% of domestic tourists in central Auckland who went to central Auckland visited these places, but also a good sort of proportion around the other regions of Auckland as well. And this has been collected since 2018. So showing some trends. They've been pretty similar. Now this shows the visitors to heritage attractions, and so these are just a random selection. When I first started this up, I sent out a whole lot of emails to different heritage attractions, seeing if they had data about the number of visitors to their places. And I got responses from these ones, so I've kept these going every year. And so you can see that generally, over time, these have increased over the past couple of past four years or so. But of course, with the COVID pandemic, these have all of them have seen a decrease. Although in the past, this was to the middle of the year, there was increase for Auckland Museum and also MOTACT and Par Homestead as well. But there's sure to be another decrease for next year's data. And did a little bit of delving into the impacts of the COVID-19 lockdowns on heritage attractions. I just thought that would be quite interesting to do. So I asked various questions to these heritage attractions, and got some more data from them. So this graph here shows 2019 as a baseline. So if you just use 2019 as that zero line, this shows what the effect of the COVID lockdowns had. So quarter two in 2020, so that's from around April, May, June. That was when we had our first lockdown, and you can see there, of course, the visitor numbers dropped, and same with quarter three. But then there was actually a bit of a bounce back with people visiting places, which is sort of shown also with some parts of the economy as well. So that was quite interesting seeing that bounce back with a few attractions. And then a bit of a decrease in quarter one when we had that small lockdown in February of this year. And then a bit more of a bounce back in quarter two of this year. But I did this in the middle of this year, so it didn't take into account the latest lockdown, which has been the longest one. So they did mention that they ended up using more online tools and social media as a result of these lockdowns. But also that many events had to be cancelled, and in some cases this would have brought in some cases thousands of visitors to attractions. And of course a whole lot of other disruptions of postponement, so work trying to fit in moving around dates for various events. But they did say that they had been learning from previous lockdowns, so that it was sort of getting easier with the February one. But I'm not sure how they have been dealing with the latest one. We'll be sure to find out next year. So now I just thought I'd show you this really interesting survey, which was done in 2019. I think you'll be quite interested in this one if you haven't heard about it before. So in 2019, as part of the Auckland Heritage Counts program, I did a survey through the Auckland Council People's Panel. If you don't know what this is a panel that anyone can sign up to, and you get sent around 1 to 2 surveys from various topics every month, and if you fill it in, then you get a prize of some sort. I think it's $50 or $100 or something like that. I've done it a few times, but unfortunately haven't been able to get any of the prizes. So it was open in June 2019 and sent to 19,000 panelists, and there was a 12% response rate, which was actually, I was told by the People's Panel team, quite a good response rate and quite standard for other surveys. And the last survey was done in 2011, so I was able to use some of the same questions in the previous one. But also just to note that there are some selection biases in this survey, because as you can tell, there are some people, or anyone can sign up to this survey and anyone can choose whether or not to answer it. And you can see that compared with the census and who answered the survey, that the people in older age brackets tended to answer it more than the survey. And also with the ethnicity of respondents, 91% of respondents being New Zealand European compared with 61% of the census. But in saying that, that was a huge survey of 2,292 people and had some really good and interesting findings. So I'll share some of those with you. So one of the questions was, what heritage related activity have you done in the last 12 months? And 94% of respondents said that they had done a heritage related activity in the last 12 months. So that was up from 78% in the 2011 survey. And these are the findings. So 81% said that they had been to a historic park, 67% a museum, and 62% visited a maunga or volcanic cone. And what was quite interesting also about the survey was that was the demographic insights. So for example, those under 35 are less likely to have visited a historic house or property than other age groups. And those of Asian descent who answered the survey are less likely to have participated in any of these activities. And those aged over 75 are less likely to participate in these more active sort of heritage-related activities. And another question was, how interested are you in Auckland's heritage? And 83% of all respondents said that they were either interested or very interested in Auckland's heritage. And so that's quite a high number. And it was quite interesting seeing the breakdown according to the age groups. And as you can see there on the screen, that there are, you can see there that generally the older you are, the more likely you are to be interested in heritage. But in saying that, those under 35 still 73% saying they were interested in heritage, which is still a very high number. And of the ethnicities who answered the survey, the highest interest were among Maori residents, Maori respondents, which were 85% said that they were interested in heritage. The lowest interest among ethnicities was among Asian respondents, 75%, but even that 75% is still very high. We also had a question about what types of heritage you are interested in. And these related, and so you can see the findings there. So from memory, they were asked to put in the top three, so choose three of these that they were most interested in. So you can see the top one was historic, civic, or institutional buildings, and historic gardens and trees, historic commercial buildings, residential buildings and Maori heritage sites. And also had some really interesting demographic insights with these as well. So just you can see here there, so the bars in blue are the younger age brackets, and the ones in green are the older age brackets. And you can see here that with both of these historic residential buildings and historic places of worship, that generally the older age groups tend to be more interested in these types of places. And the opposite is true for historic military sites. You can see there that the younger age groups tended to have a high proportion being interested in these. And with in terms of ethnicity, Maori heritage sites, 79% of Maori said that they're interested in Maori heritage sites, and 64% of Pacific respondents said that they were interested in Maori heritage sites. And what was also quite interesting was this one here about historic monuments and structures. You can see there 51% of Asian respondents picked this what kind of heritage they're most interested in, some monuments and structures. So these are memorials or statues and things like that. And in the survey, we also asked or had these statements, and people could choose if they agreed or disagreed with these statements, and had some really interesting and responses and quite positive towards heritage. And one that stands out for me is that 87% one sort of midway down there, that it is important to protect heritage places even though I may never visit them. So 87% saying that they agreed with that statement. So it's even though they're not, they may never visit the place. So it's really for others and for future generations. So just knowing that they are there is giving value. And there's also some really interesting demographic insights for these as well. So you see down the bottom the statement, we protect too much heritage. And on the left there, that shows the breakdown according to the ages of respondents. And you can see once again that the generally the older age brackets tend to disagree more with the statement than the younger age brackets. And with this one here, Auckland's heritage is not relevant to me or my family. You can see the breakdown with ethnicities. And one that stands out there is the Asian respondents, which 22% said that they agreed with that statement, which was higher than the other groups. And how important do you think the protection of heritage is? So 91% said that they thought that this was important, and that was up from 88% from 2011, but pretty much the same proportion. And this is just showing the correlation between those interested in heritage and the perspective of the importance of heritage. So really it's just saying what we would expect, that people who are interested in heritage are also more likely to think it's important to protect heritage. And the so that dark green there with this question also allowed for free text, so people could write in answers. And they found, so they, there's this sort of the general themes. So important to remember our history when planning for the future. Heritage is part of who we are and that future generations need to experience it. And that small 2% sliver down the bottom there, people who gave no importance to protecting heritage. And this is where I had those quotes from the that I showed in an earlier slide. So people feeling that it gets in the way of progress, often too young to have heritage, and the cost of maintaining heritage is too high. And I just thought I'd finish by showing you this this case study, or this from 2019. So this was done by Polly Smith, a Heritage Masters graduate from the University of Auckland. And she took up this opportunity to look at heritage societies, to sort of do a bit more research into heritage societies, which I was really pleased that she took that up. So with just a little bit of a background, so she looked at over 70 heritage organisations or historical societies throughout the Auckland region and had 80 questionnaire responses and interviewed 57 volunteers. So who are they? So once again, tend to be in the older age brackets, so over 65. They are also most are retired, 55%. Most are female, 58%, but still 40% male. And the majority being New Zealand European ethnicity. And they're also happy. 85% volunteers stated that they're happy with volunteering, and they also have a strong sense of loyalty and commitment, with the majority, 73%, saying that they've been a member for 6 or more years. And also very interested in heritage, 91% saying that they were interested in heritage. And 95% believing that heritage is an asset and not a liability. And but also being 95% saying that they're concerned about the loss of heritage. And this is the type of work that they do. So they're very busy and do a huge amount of work. So for example, guided walks and visits, advocating for heritage and doing historical research. So they do a huge amount of work there. And why do they do it? What are their motivations behind it? So they have it's really for their passion for heritage, either in general or for a specific heritage place. And also just the feeling of doing something for the community and being able to meet others and for social reasons. And just about the future of heritage society. So they're generally positive towards the future, but of course this was done in 2019, so before the pandemic happened, so hopefully they're doing all right out there and they're still going strong. So so that's it. So hopefully these have been of interest to you all, and it's given you some of the highlights from the latest edition, and also a couple of highlights from past editions. So as I mentioned, the 2021 edition has, if it's not on the website now, it will be on definitely by the end of the week. And you can, the link is down the bottom of the page there, but you can also search for Auckland's Heritage Counts program, Auckland Council. If you just search for that, it should come up. And also keep an eye on our Auckland Heritage social media. That will also have a link, as well as lots of other interesting heritage news. And yeah, I just want to thank again all the people who have helped with the Auckland Heritage Counts program, and also just generally for the great work that's going on in the heritage sector around Auckland.